Hello everyone, welcome to Atoms and Sporks, and in this video I want to talk about how quantum physics makes solar power possible. Because without this wonderful thing called quantum theory, solar panels, or what we in jargony talk call photovoltaic cells, wouldn't exist. Now right away, this idea might actually seem a bit suspicious. It's maybe not so shocking to hear that photovoltaic cells work through what is called the photovoltaic effect. And if you were to Google the history of this photovoltaic effect, you'd find that its discovery predates the development of quantum physics by almost 50 years. In fact, you'd probably find that the first commercial solar cell was already invented about 20 years before people like Max Planck and Albert Einstein even made the very first baby steps towards quantum theory. So how can I possibly claim that solar cells are a quantum technology? Well, to understand that, let's actually take a look at that very first photovoltaic cell. Now, Charles Fritz was an inventor. And in 1883, he realized that if he took a slab of selenium and sandwiched it between two thin layers of different metals, specifically he used brass on the bottom and a thin layer of gold on the top, that when he shone sunlight on this material sandwich, he would get a small electrical current. Now old Chucky Fritz was not the first person to notice that selenium did some funny things when it made contact with various metals. This previous work is what gave him the idea, but what he was ambitious. You see, 1883 was the early days of electrification, the days of Edison and Tesla, and what he was the first to do was realize that there was interest in such a device. And he even went as far as to actually send his invention to a prominent industrialist of the time for verification, a guy by the name of Werner von Siemens, the guy who founded the now massive Siemens Corporation. Now, Fritz's cell had a sunlight conversion efficiency of like 1%, which is pretty terrible for the purposes of generating energy, but it could, and was at least, used as an electrical light detector, what we call a photodiode today. But so the first cell was in 1883, but then what happened? Well, if you then kept reading your historical timeline, you'd find nothing. Really, no progress at all until 60 years later, in the 1940s, where the first modern cell was built at a place called Bell Labs. And that cell had an efficiency about 10 times higher than the Fritz device. And it's from that time, in the 1940s onwards, that we then start to see the steady year-on-year improvements of a developing technology, a quantum technology. You see, Fritz, by accident, by sandwiching selenium, which is what we now call a semiconductor material, between two different metals, had created the basic ingredients needed to create a solar cell, though he had no clue why, and had no idea how it worked, and therefore how to improve it. And it was only in the 1930s and 40s, once the quantum physics of solids became a field, that we understood what was going on, and then could push things forward. We could design, engineer, and improve the behavior once we actually understood how it worked. But how exactly do they work? Well, in order to understand that, we need to understand three things about what quantum physics says about how electrons behave in a piece of solid material like Chucky Fritz's selenium slab. Now, the first thing we need to understand is that according to quantum physics, an electron trapped in a lone individual atom can only have certain discrete quantized energies, and an electron in a solid, like a chunk of selenium or silicon, can have a continuum of energies, called bands, interspersed with ranges of energies called band gaps, which represent energies that no electron in the solid can have. The reason for this is something we actually talked about at length in a previous video. So if you want to understand a bit more about why this happens, just go check out that video. But to avoid repeating here, we'll simply say that this is a result of applying quantum physics to the situation an electron finds itself in a solid. And it is completely unlike our macroscopic world. A baseball, for example, can have any speed or energy it wants. No one tells it can't go a certain speed. But an electron in a solid is limited. There are certain continuous ranges it can have, punctuated by ranges it simply cannot have. In fact, physicists often talk actually about what is called the density of states of a material, which is a graph like this. This density of states is actually kind of like a unique fingerprint that makes one material different from another. If someone hands you one of these graphs, you can know not only what material it is, but quite a bit about how it will behave. And what determines this density of states is not just the elements that make up the material, like say silicon versus germanium, but even the same element in a different crystal configuration, like carbon and graphite versus carbon and a diamond, will have a different density of states. And these graphs show not just what energies an electron in that material can have, but also how many different states that are valid according to quantum physics there are with that energy. Note here that even though the number of electron states is actually a whole number, you know, an integer, in any given energy range, there will be trillions and trillions of states for electrons because there are trillions and trillions of electrons in a macroscopic chunk of material. And because of that, we don't draw these graphs as actually made of like a trillion little discrete dots representing each actual state, but instead draw them as continuous lines, since any actual granularity would be outrageously tiny. However, for today's purposes of understanding, I am actually going to simplify and draw my density of states graphs as if they're actually only a handful of distinct states of each energy. But just don't get confused if you Google density of states and find graphs that look like this and not this. And it's actually very important to know how many states there are at each energy, and that's because of our second key property of quantum physics. No two electrons can ever be in the same state. This is called the Pauli exclusion principle, and it has absolutely no analogy in our macroscopic world. If you're hoping for like an intuitive analogy here, you're just not going to find one, as nothing in pre-quantum physics behaves like this. Now, what makes a state unique in a solid is its energy, its momentum, and its angular momentum, or what we call spin. That's why there are more than one state with the same energy. The states have the same energy, but different momenta and spins. But according to this strange property of quantum physics, no two electrons in a solid can ever have the same combination of momentum, spin, and energy at the same time. And we can maybe talk about why this is the case another time and get into a heady talk about global symmetries and entanglement. But for now, if we just take it as something that is true, then this simple fact leads to some pretty profound and strange behavior. And what matters most for photovoltaics is that it has some huge effects on how an electron, when it is given extra energy and is excited, loses or dissipates that extra energy and relaxes back to equilibrium. Both the process of excitation and this process of relaxation proceed very differently in the quantum world of solids than in everyday life. And it is in fact these differences that solar panels rely on. To understand this, imagine two different situations here. In both these situations, we have it that below a certain energy, all electron states are filled, and above that energy, all those states are empty. Of course, this isn't just like some random situation. This is actually what you'll find in any solid when it's at thermal equilibrium. It happens because electrons will try and take the lowest energy state they can. But because of this Pauli exclusion, one electron per state business, only a few lucky electrons can actually fill up the lowest energy states and then it's full. And that means that the next electrons have to settle for a higher energy state. It's like filling a school bus where everyone wants a seat at the back, but it can't happen. The first people get the back seats, but once they're filled, the next people have to go to the second last row. And then when that's filled, you settle for the third last row, and so on until all the kids, or electrons, are seated. And that is the world of electrons in the solid. And this also means that even at like absolute zero, the coldest possible temperature, electrons in a solid will have quite a bit of energy, because they're so-called Pauli blocked from having any less. At least, that's the case at absolute zero. At regular room temperatures, this line is still very clear, but there are some small number of electrons near the top who have a little extra energy. And what we're looking at here is the difference between a metal, where the last electron to find a seat found one in the middle of a band, and a semiconductor or insulator, where the last electron filled up a band. as to which situation you get actually just comes down to the number of electrons per sort of like primitive unit cell of the crystal lattice of the material. And also note that a semiconductor, by the way, is actually just a word for an insulator whose band gap isn't super big. So really, semiconductors aren't technically their own thing. They're technically a subclass of insulators with relatively small band gaps. That's really all a semiconductor is. And all of this is also the real, true, fundamental, honest-to-Betsy physicist's definition for what makes something a metal or an insulator. It all comes down to this band structure and where the filling level of these electrons falls, and whether it fills out a band or not. But okay, why does this matter for solar panels? Well, the electrons in the solar panel are absorbing sunlight, and as a result, they're absorbing the energy of that light and becoming excited, and so they are sent out of equilibrium. But an excited electron sticks out like a sore thumb because it has way more energy than everything around it. There's the atomic nuclei of the lattice, there's impurity atoms, there's other electrons, and a given electron is constantly scattering and interacting with these things. But this lucky electron who absorbed that light energy has way more than the crowd. So what happens? Well, on average, it will constantly trade energy with its environment until its energy relaxes back down, and the average total energy of the solid is brought up just a teeny bit until things go back to equilibrium. It does this sharing by constant interaction and collisions. And for a metal, this energy relaxation can happen in an incredible variety of ways. It could lose a little cheeky bit of energy here by a glancing collision with an impurity atom. It could have a solid impact with another electron. It could create a lattice vibration. It's all good for a metal. So because there are so many options, the overall process is very fast. Like, an excited electron in a metal will literally only hold on to that excess energy for like a femtosecond before dissipating it all and sharing it around with collisions. But the situation here with the semiconductor is very different. Here we have an electron that has been just excited above the band gap. How can this guy relax back down? Well, unlike a metal, it can't just hand off a bit of energy to any random impurity or electron in any old collision like some lowly pleb. No, because if it just lost a little bit of energy, it would need to end up in a state that doesn't exist. A state in a band gap. In order for a scattering event to happen, it has to end up in a valid final state. But for all lower energies, our electron is kinda screwed, both because of the band gap and because everything below the band gap is already filled. That is, except for one very, very specific state, the hole it left behind. If it wants to relax, it kinda has to like thread the needle. Any collision that doesn't give it exactly the right amount of energy, momentum, and spin to slide back into that state simply won't happen. And that is incredible to think about. That is so weird and different from our macroscopic experience. Imagine like a baseball that was thrown at a certain speed, and that speed just became like locked in. It couldn't slow down, its direction couldn't change, not even its spinning could change, unless it found the perfect Goldilocks collision that gave it exactly the right change in speed, direction, and spin it could accept. It's so odd, but that's the quantum mechanical world of electrons and solids. And pragmatically, what that means is that interband energy relaxation, you know, an electron bleeding off energy to pass between bands, is a very unlikely and thus very slow process, where intraband or within a band relaxation is very fast. In fact, interband relaxation is about 10,000 times slower at room temperature, because almost all scattering would result in transitions to states that are forbidden either by the gap or by Pauli blocking. And this is two-thirds of how a solar panel works. A quanta or photon of light is absorbed by an electron somewhere inside the solar cell, and solar cells are designed in some way, and we'll get to that, so that they natively, at all times, have a permanent built-in electric field in their interior. But what is the effect of this built-in electric field? Well, an electric field in, say, this direction will apply a pushing force on an electron in this direction, and thus sweep it to the left. In fact, this hole it left behind will also do something very important as well, but we'll maybe ignore that part in this video. But it is important. But okay, so that's basically the name of the game. Light is absorbed to excite electrons, then this persistent electric field sweeps them towards the contacts, and any excess energy they still have, when they get there, is renewable electricity for us. But any energy they dissipate or lose to heat before making it to the metal contacts, well, that's just lost. It went basically to making a slightly hotter solar panel, nothing else. And by using a semiconductor, the interband relaxation is suppressed and unlikely, and gives the electrons a real shot to hold on to their extra energy as they make the trip, where in something like a metal, they would relax incredibly fast. But that leads to our last question. How do we make it so that this semiconductor naturally has a permanent built-in electric field? Well, that brings us to our third and final quantum property, the ability to make quantum junctions. Remember when we said that every material has a different density of states with a different electron filling level? Well, then what happens if you take two different materials and bring them into contact? Well, as we can see, in general, both their bands and their electron filling levels aren't going to line up. So what does the system do? Well, far away from the touching point, you basically just have the materials behaving like they normally do. But in a small region connecting the two, in order to find a kind of equilibrium, you'll get a kind of transition region. And we call these transition regions junctions. And look what happens to, say, an electron here at the higher filling as it crosses this junction. Well, if it doesn't lose any energy, then where it initially was an equilibrium electron on this side, it's actually an excited electron on the other side. It's effectively being accelerated. By what? Well, whenever you have a slope like this in your sort of band profiles, what that actually means is that an electric field has emerged. Junctions between different materials imply the emergence of permanent electric fields, and those are precisely how we get our electric field in our solar cell. And even though good old Chucky Fritz didn't know it back in 1883, he'd done this when he took his solid piece of selenium and stuck it between two different metals. We call this kind of energy band bending, or permanent electric field formation, a Schottky junction, when it happens between a metal and a semiconductor. Though actually, Fritz's design is not really how we do it today. Instead, we engineer these junctions within the semiconductor itself. We do this by inserting impurity atoms, you know, stuff that isn't silicon, on only one side of the silicon slab. In fact, we often shoot these impurity atoms in with a particle accelerator. And we've chosen these inserted atoms carefully, so that, according to the periodic table, they are mostly similar to silicon, being quite close so they won't distort the crystal lattice much, but that they have either one more or one less electron than silicon. By doing this, we can basically keep the density of states mostly the same, but what we actually vary is the filling of the electrons on one side of the cell versus the other side, and thus make, again, a permanent built-in electric field. We call a junction like this, that is baked into a single solid piece of semiconductor by spatially varying where impurity atoms are placed, a PN junction. And that's actually all a solar cell is. It is a semiconductor PN junction. So those are our three quantum ingredients that make a solar panel work. By the way, if you would like to know how quantum physics also dictates the fundamental limits of solar power and what we can maybe do to circumvent these theoretical limits, I might do a follow-up video to this. So let me know in the comments if that's of interest. Also, if you want to know more about how these quantum junctions basically form the basis of the entire digital age, check out the description for a list of videos that explore this further. Anyways, I hope you enjoyed the video. Please like and subscribe if you did, and have a good one.